We are live. We are live with Food for Thought Live, episode 7. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us again, everybody. It's lovely to see you. Hope you've had a good day. It's a beautiful evening here in London. I know we have people joining us from all over the world. And this is a very special episode, but not for a number of reasons. One is my guest is a very special guest, and I'm very, very excited about introducing you guys. Two, we are, for the first time, broadcasting live on YouTube, on a very, very brand new, shiny YouTube channel for Food for Thought. So that's happening in parallel with Facebook. So this is going to be an interesting one to see how that goes. And the reason that's so good for this broadcast and further future broadcasts is the simple reason that up until today, people who didn't have a Facebook account couldn't watch these interviews, and lots of people wanted to. So now, if you have any friends, family, anyone who you think might be interested in these interviews, you can send them the link to our YouTube and they can watch them live as well. So we're really excited about that. And what better way to celebrate our inaugural YouTube broadcast, our YouTube maiden flight, than to invite on a legend of wildlife conservation. Yes, that's right. I said legend. So it's a wonderful evening for me, because this is a good friend of mine, someone who I know always gets a little bit embarrassed when I say he's a hero of mine, but he is a hero of mine, and I know a lot of other people as well. It's my great pleasure to welcome Mr. Will Travers from the Born Free Foundation. You are muted. Yeah.
Ooh.
No, you're not. No, we're good.
You muted me.
Why would I do that after that introduction?
Yeah, no, thank you very much. How lovely to see you, Dan.
It's so lovely to see you, and I'm so excited about our both of us with our hairstyles, and that we have any. I'm seriously thinning, but I'm very, very impressed with our lockdown hairstyles, and I hope you all are too. That's what we need to talk about tonight.
What we need is our other patron, Daniel Galvin, to come on the show and tell us how to get all these locks. But anyway, never mind. Let's move swiftly on.
Let's stay on hairstyles. I think it's a good idea. No, look, I'm so grateful to you for coming on. Thank you very, very much for being here, and especially for our very first ever YouTube broadcast. We're so pleased to have you on for this special evening. And Born Free is a very special organization to me. I've been a patron for you guys for some years now, and it's such an honor. I actually sobbed like a little child when I was told that I was being made a patron, and that's that really was a highlight of my life. And Born Free, I think, has been an integral part and a very very profound part of a lot of people's lives, and it's just turned 36 years old. We had a wonderful 35th anniversary last year. You've just celebrated your 36th Born Free Foundation birthday, and you have literally been there from the very beginning, haven't you?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously I was a young child at the time. No, I wasn't. But no, this is it. This is the job. This is the life. This is the mission. And I've been hugely fortunate to have been part of this right from day one, right from that very first day when I'll give you a little bit of the background, because there'll be people watching who'll know the full story, and there'll be people who may not. So let me just kind of fill in a few blanks, and then we can move it forward from there. So as you say, 36 years, but it goes back, obviously, way before that, to when the film Born Free was made. We all went as a family to Kenya in 1964, and I was 5 years old then, so you can work it out. And we lived in Kenya for nearly a year while the film was made. Originally, it was sort of thought of as almost like a sort of large-scale documentary, but it soon turned into sort of Panavision and all the rest of it. And the film was a huge success. And I think part of the reason for that success, Dan, was because in those days there was no computer-generated graphics. There was, you know, none of the visual aids and trickery that we've become so used to, and that can create alternative universes, parallel universes on our screens. So what you see in that film is what you get. You know, those scenes with mum and dad and lions are for real. And it took a lot of courage, I think, to make a film like that and to be in a film like that, simply because you were taking a risk. These are not tame animals. People always say, are lions, were they tame? Well, there's no such thing as a tame lion. There's a wild lion that has a sort of a developed a relationship with human beings. And in a sense, that's what the story was all about. Mm. But there is no such thing as a tame lion. And anyone who thinks that there is, you know, go and look at what happened to Siegfried and Roy, the illusionists in Las Vegas, mm. and the tigers. And actually one of them, one of Siegfried and Roy, has just died only the other day, not because of the injuries sustained in the attack. But you cannot take those animals for granted. And I always remember the one scene that I remember probably best in terms of thinking that was very dangerous was the one, if you recall it, where my dad is in the bathroom and he's washing his face. He's got his pajama trousers on, he's washing his face, and Elsa is taking the towel. And dad is washing his face and then he's getting soap in his eyes, and then he reaches down with his eyes full of soap and sort of pats around looking with his hands for his towel, and the towel is in the mouth of a lion. And I just know that that could go any one of two ways, either really well, or the game becomes not so much of a game, but it becomes something where the lion resents the fact that the towel is being taken back from her, mm. and lashes out. And make no mistake, you know, a lashing out lion is no fun for anybody. And so I always think of those sort of little scenes as being an example of the courage that mum and dad had in making the film. Mm. And then when the film was finished, most of the lions very sadly went to captive circumstances, except for three that George Adamson and my mum and dad managed to, as it were, rescue from the film company.
Right.
They went back to the wild, and my dad made a film about it. She was a gift from the Kenya government. She was waylaid on her way to London Zoo by my mum and dad, and was in a film with them in the late 60s, but she ended up at London Zoo. She ended up, even though we said, could we have her? And they said, yes, but we'll need to take another baby elephant from the wild because we've made a promise to the zoo. Couldn't cope with that. So she went to London Zoo, where a decade or so later, we found out that she was in serious trouble. She was on her own. She'd broken a tusk. She had a little stump left. And after a lot of pressure, the zoo agreed eventually to try and move her from the Regent's Park Zoo to their sister zoo in the country, Whipsnade, where at least she wouldn't have been on her own. The move failed. She collapsed. A week later, they gave her a general anesthetic to look at a damaged leg. She had lost the will to live, and she was destroyed in the elephant house. And that brings me full circle back to that 36 years, because we got in a room one day with three other people, and we all put a pound on the table. Six of us put a pound on the table, and that was our starting capital for what is today the Born Free Foundation.
What an incredible story. And thank goodness that's the route you guys took, because I mean, that was never the plan going into the film, was it? This, as you say, was inspired by the emotions and the feelings that were brought about by the interaction with the animals from that film and others. And as you say, Poli Poli. And here we are 36 years later with Born Free having done so, so much. And we'll get through some of that.
I think it was because we didn't, when we were looking at the situation for Poli Poli in London Zoo, it seemed like no one was asking the difficult questions. No one was saying, why have we got large exotic mammals in the middle of London or Birmingham or wherever it happened to be? Mm. No one was asking those questions. And although we were no experts, and we don't really claim to be experts now, we have lots of experts who support us. Because no one was asking the questions, it became headline news. And we had Joanna Lumley and we had Ronnie Corbett and we had all sorts of people who just somehow resonated with the message and said, you know, we feel that too. And thousands of members of the public who also said, I'm not comfortable with what I see when I go to the zoo, this alien environment, these small alien enclosures, animals often behaving in strange and you know, unfathomable ways, the kind of behavior that you might see with someone who has serious mental health issues.
Right.
We were actually approached by people studying mental health issues in humans and saying, I am seeing exactly this sort of behavior that you're showing in animals in my human patients. And there is a correlation there. So, and then of course, what that did is it led to a big question, a really big question, which is, well, if you don't like zoos, what do you want? What's the alternative? Because the narrative that sits behind the zoo proposition is that you'll learn stuff and that it's conservation and it's research.
Mm.
And when you start to unpick that, you realize that with a few exceptions, it's really not any of the above. It is primarily a public display facility where exotic animals are put on display for people to come on a Saturday. That's really kind of the bottom line.
Of course.
And so if we don't like that, and which we don't, and if you don't like wild animals in circuses, which we don't, and if you don't want exotic animals as pets, which we don't, what do you want? And the answer is, we want to keep wildlife in the wild. And if that means we never see it because we can't travel to see it or for whatever reason, it is enough for us to say that we are doing our best to keep wildlife in its natural habitat and protect that natural habitat and those wild animals for future generations.
And I think that speaks volumes about the ethos behind Born Free. And that's something that I know I'm grateful for and a lot of other people, millions no doubt, are grateful for as well. And you know, I want to touch upon your philosophy about compassionate conservation as well. But one of the things you just said really interests me, and I'd love to get your thoughts on it. You talked about that's the bottom line, and ultimately, you know, no pun intended, or perhaps there was one, but it's all about the bottom line for zoos. It's all about profit. It's all about, and of course, there's a lot of talk of zoos contributing to conservation, which to an extent they do. Sometimes in because they're forced to, but it's the same kind of the argument that you hear presented with trophy hunting contributing to conservation. I'm really curious to know, specific to captivity, where do you stand on that whole argument that zoos contribute to conservation?
Well, I think it would be naive to suggest that there is no contribution, that no zoo has ever made a contribution to conservation. That would be naive. But I look at it in a much broader sense than that. I say there are 10,000 zoos around the world, and their turnover every year runs into billions of dollars, billions of pounds. And they contain probably in the order of about 10 million animals in captivity, largely there for our pleasure, our entertainment. They are, I mean, it's kind of weird and sad, but also revealing that right now, here we all are doing exactly what you and I are doing. We're not down the pub having a chat. We're miles and miles apart having a conversation because we can't go out.
Right.
We are in lockdown, and millions and billions of people are in lockdown. And we are perhaps for the first time experiencing what it's like to have that fundamental value removed from us, sort of forcibly removed from us. Obviously, we're sort of willing in this process, but nevertheless, we are being told to stay at home, and our freedom is being removed. And I was thinking about freedom the other day, Dan, and I was thinking about the various, you know, of the values that we think of as vitally important to our humanity. Freedom is probably right up there. You know, Statue of Liberty, as you enter New York Harbor, Liberté, Égalité, Fraternité is the motto of the French Republic. The civil rights movement in America is based about freedom for all to vote, freedom to be equal under the law. Freedom is so profoundly important to us that what we do to people who transgress the norms of life, people who break the rules, short of taking away their life, which we don't do in this country, thankfully, we take away their freedom. We lock them up. That is the biggest punishment that we think that we can serve on a person who has broken the rules, is to take away their freedom. And yet, we treat the deprivation of freedom, the removal of freedom from wild animals in zoos and other facilities, as some kind of leisure pastime.
And this talks beautifully to that point I wanted to turn to regarding Born Free's philosophy about compassionate conservation, which simply put means that every single animal matters, because there'll be people who would naively argue that if there's a few tens of thousands of a certain species, that you could take one here, one there, and that's not the end of the world. But of course, to that animal, it absolutely is the end of the world. Can you talk a bit more about that philosophy of compassionate conservation and how that fits with this?
Yeah, I mean, just that point about, a little bit of suffering, a little bit of slavery, it's not acceptable. You can't, I don't think you can equate the removal of the rights of one individual with the access to those rights for many others. I don't think that's a trade-off. Ethically, I find that massively inconsistent. And people say, well, what about safari parks? Aren't they, in this country, in the UK, for example, aren't they much better? And I would say that actually, having studied this, it's more about the illusion of freedom to us than the freedom that the animals have.
Right.
Because we live in largely urban environments where our sense of space is defined by the park down the road, or when you go to if you're allowed to in the future, go to a sports event and you see a big open space where people play sport and you watch it. Those are back garden. Those are our sort of defining limits of space. So when you go to a quote safari park and you see lions in, 4 or 5 acres, 6 acres, 8 acres, you're kind of seduced into thinking that they're free, except that when you study this, you realize that lions have home ranges running into thousands and thousands and thousands of acres per animal, square miles, many square miles per pride. And so it is more about our psychology and our acceptance of freedom defined than it is about the reality of freedom for those animals. But going to your point about compassionate conservation. So, I'll try and just very quickly define it. So there is conservation, and in old school thinking, in my view, you can do something bad to a few animals of a species as long as there is a greater benefit to the species as a whole. It's an argument that, as you say, trophy hunters try to ply, and I completely, profoundly, and utterly reject that. And I believe that when you talk about conservation, you should also consider the individual animals that are part of your conservation effort. You should be basing your conservation outcomes on good things happening, or the least possible negative things happening to animals as part of that conservation effort. The individual really matters. And Dan, I know we've talked about this before. You have a social security number. So do I. We don't want to be known for our social security number. That's not
right.
What defines us. What defines us is Dan Richardson or Will or the many people hopefully watching this show.
Right.
We're defined by our experience and our character and our relationships with others as individuals. I refuse to be a number. This is a repeat of the prisoner, but it is. I refuse to be a number, and I refuse to accept that animals should just be numbers as well, because the moment you make them numbers, you open the floodgates to all sorts of human actions imposed on those animals that you wouldn't. I'll tell you, the really crazy thing was the guy who shot Cecil, the lion, is quoted as saying, Mr. Palmer, is quoted as saying, if I'd known he had a name, I wouldn't have done it. Now that, from a psychological point of view, is extremely interesting.
Isn't
in other
it?
Words, if I'd known this was an animal, an individual, if I'd known this animal as an individual, I wouldn't have done it. Well, then we have to know all animals as individuals. We have to work to that end.
I'm sure everyone listening will agree that is not just an incredibly effective and important philosophy, but a beautiful one as well, which is why I find it so, it resonates so deeply with me. And speaking about individual animals, this guy. Now, I've called this, for anyone who doesn't know, is is king.
And this is your story. You should tell this story.
Well, I can tell some of it because I had the utter privilege and honor of escorting this where is he that way this beautiful young lad to his ancestral home, thanks to Born Free. So feel free, Will, to interject if I get any of these details wrong, but I think it was in 2017 or 2018, you guys became aware of a lion cub, 3 or 4 months old, that had been purchased illegally in Paris, France, by somebody who I believe was in his early to mid-20s and had subsequently put video of himself on social media, tragically but thankfully, beating up the lion cub. I apologize to those of you who are hearing this for the first time because it's quite upsetting, but thankfully the guy was as stupid as he was cruel, because he did exactly that. He put his video on the internet, I think it was Snapchat or whatever it was, and he literally had on a pair of boxing gloves and was punching the lion cub, which was the size of a puppy at this time of his life, and under the size of a lion of any age that it should have been, because it was so malnourished. The guy was keeping it in a dog cage in an apartment in Paris, and had abused it in that way. And thankfully, through his stupidity in putting it on social media, thankfully he was apprehended, arrested, and King, as his name is, was taken to a wonderful halfway house, shall we say, Nature Help Centrum in Belgium, which is one of the most wonderful organizations. In fact, they usually watch these broadcasts, Ingrid and Rudy. They can't be here tonight because they're out looking after animals for the umpteenth night in a row, which is their life. They're incredible people, and they support Born Free, and they asked me to say thank you and hello, Will, because they love you guys to bits. King was housed there for about 6 months, I think it was, or possibly 9, while you guys handled all the extensive paperwork and logistics involved in transporting a lion from Europe to Africa on about 4 plane journeys through about as many international borders. And it's not just a case of getting visas like you and I would. It's a case of some extensive and I imagine very laborious logistics and work that needed to be done, all culminating in the fact that I then had the absolute privilege of traveling with the team from Born Free to Belgium to then bring King back by road to Heathrow, from there on Kenya Airways to Nairobi, then transfer from Nairobi to Joburg, from Joburg to Port Elizabeth, and then by road from Port Elizabeth to the Shamwari Game Reserve, where Born Free Foundation have their big cat sanctuary, which is a true sanctuary. And I had the unbelievable experience of watching King emerge from his traveling crate to step for the very first time in his life onto African soil, under the African sunshine. It was the most profoundly beautiful and moving thing I've ever seen. And it was all thanks to Born Free. And of course, that's just one of many. I get to tell that story because of the fact that I had the honor of escorting King and the team. But this is what you do. This is the kind of work you do. And if ever there was an example of compassionate conversation, and every animal matters, King is such a beautiful example of that, I think.
Well, thank you. You've told that story both accurately but also beautifully. And those are the successes that any organization and its supporters feed off, because there's so much tragedy out there, there's so many challenges out there that, you know, one can feel overwhelmed sometimes. You feel like it's a mountain that you cannot continue to climb. And the very fact that we're here 36 years in is because we have had successes, like taking the last captive dolphins from the UK, 3 of the last, back to the wild in the Caribbean, or setting dolphins free that come from a Turkish dolphin area, or rescuing tigers from a circus and taking them to India many years ago. These are the things that keep us going. And I have to say that, you know, right now, when we're thinking about what will the world look like when we come out of COVID-19, you know, what is the future? And people are saying this, or everyone's saying this, we can't go back to business as usual. But they can't really work out what that means. They say it, but they don't yet have a vision of what that is. And that's kind of understandable because we're still right in the thick of it. But I think that one of the things, or some of the things that will change, I for one, and born free as well, will fly far less. We will we will cherish and treasure the opportunity to travel. We will not do what Mark Ruffalo, the amazing actor, said the other day on the Graham Norton show. He said, no more disposable travel for me. And I thought, that is just the right phrase. That doesn't mean no more travel, but no more of that kind of, oh yeah, I'm going to go and have, you know, 10 weekends a year in on city breaks. Or I'm going to go for that meeting in New York where I'll be one of 15 people and I'll speak for probably 5 minutes, but I'll fly all the way to New York for my 5 minutes of fame. We've got to get away from disposable travel. We've got to cherish travel. And the kind of travel that I think we perhaps should be investing in is to tell, is to give King and others like him the opportunity of a life worth living, and to, through that, tell a story, tell a really important story about how wild animals are not disposable, like travel is not disposable.
Again, Will, just beautifully put. And as we're talking about lions, and of course, as you quite rightly said, Born Free doesn't exist solely because of lions, but also Poli Poli and other animals as well. But one of the key issues that you are currently dealing with and campaigning against and fighting hard against is the canned lion hunting industry. And I know I'm going to pull up an animation and show that in a while, but can you just tell us a little bit about that? Because you obviously you're this wealth of knowledge on the subject, and I think that there's still, I've talked about this before on these broadcasts, we who are involved in this movement, the animal conservation, animal welfare movement, we, especially with social media working the way it does, with algorithms behaving as they do, we live in a bubble and we think everyone understands, everyone knows. And as you quite rightly stated at the beginning, not everyone even knows who Born Free is. Can you explain a little bit about how this process works with lions? And I'll after you've done so, I'll put the animation up for people to see, because it's an award-winning animation. It will also get your tissues ready, but please, Will, give us a little bit of a rundown on what this issue is.
Yeah, it's so I'm just going to start by talking about lions in general, because when the film Born Free was made, it's estimated there were somewhere between 100,000, possibly as many as 200,000 wild lions across Africa, and today there are 20,000. And that's the reality of what's happening, and that is as a result of many different things. It's land that's been lost, land that lions use that is now lost and is used for other purposes. It's persecution. A lion kills some livestock, people kill the lion. It is lions shot as trophies, wild free-living lions shot as trophies. It's the prey base that they normally predate on. So the antelopes and the gazelles and the zebras and the wildebeest are also diminishing, and so lions turn to other sources of food for their very survival. And the pretty much easiest thing to take down is a goat or a sheep or a cow. It's got no wild instincts at all. But on top of all of that, which we definitely have to get to grips with, and Born Free is working hard in several places in Kenya to try and both sort of support and make more resilient the lion population, there is this other atrocity. I can only describe it as an atrocity, because it's almost impossible to think of any aspect of it that has any redeeming qualities at all. And it's this, as you describe it, the canned hunting industry. In South Africa, there are between 250 and 300 captive breeding facilities that breed predators, mainly lions. There are somewhere between 8 and 12,000 lions and other predators in those facilities. And what happens is that a female will give birth to some cubs, and within a matter of days, the cubs are taken away from the female and they're hand raised by paying volunteers who think, have been told, that these are orphans and that they need help. So these people are doing it, in a sense, for all the right reasons, but they don't know the whole story. And then when the cub is too old to be in that circumstance, the cub goes walking with other paying guests for an hour, and people pay another $50 or $60 to walk with a lion, an adolescent lion. They are suckered into that as well. And then the lion is now too big, too big to be cuddled and too big to be walked. And there is only one fate awaiting this lion. And that is that, and you can go on to the site of the company and you can choose, select the lion that you will kill. You could be in Nevada or you could be in Dusseldorf or you could be in London and you can select your lion, fly to South Africa, go on a hunting safari for 3 days, which is really just spuddling around, kind of doing nothing because the outcome is already sealed. And then your chosen lion will be found for you while you're searching and you will shoot the lion in an enclosure. It's a large enclosure by our standards. It's a fraction of the lion's range with no possibility of escape as far as the lion is concerned. And in fact, they sometimes do this on what's called a no kill, no fee basis. If you don't kill the lion, you don't have to pay. How could you offer that?
Right.
Because you know there is no escape. And so you shoot the lion and you take the head back to the US or to Europe or Russia or Mexico or wherever you live to stick on the wall. And then the body parts are then sold legally and sanctioned by the South African government under a quota of 800 animals a year to the Far East to be used as an alternative to tiger products in traditional Asian medicines and in tiger bone wine, which is a tonic, restorative tonic. But if you haven't got any tiger, why not use lion instead? And that story is a story of exploitation from birth, from cradle to grave, cradle to grave. There is no redemption and there is no escape. And I find the whole thing incredibly sad and shocking. And I'm hoping, and in fact, I know that there is a book coming out about this. First of all, I should say, the people who really exposed this were a South African journalist called Ian Mickler and a producer called Pippa Hankinson. And they made an extraordinary film called Blood Lions, which blew the lid off the whole can hunting industry. And hats off to them because they did an amazing job. But we and other organizations have taken up the baton and we are running with it. And we are determined to end canned hunting industry. And one of the ways we've tried to help do that is if you have it available, this film that people should watch because it really changes your future.
It's astonishing. And I mean, I'm watching the comments come flooding in while you're talking about that. And as I say, I think the importance of people understanding is underlined by the fact, as you say, it begins with a volunteer with very good intentions, thinking they're, and no doubt because of the nature of the work, someone who's an animal lover, almost certainly an animal lover who feels they're doing something very special and very important and helpful, but actually contributing to this unbelievable lifelong cruelty. As you say, it's just one exploitation after another, all for the sake of profit, all at the expense of these beautiful animals.
Can you run that, Dan? Have you got it available, the film?
Blood Lion. Oh, yes, I have the Bitter Bond. Now, so Born Free.
I don't want to give away everything, but I will tell you that it won 2 awards recently at the Charity Film Awards. It won Best in Category and it won Silver in the People's Choice. They'd never had a Silver category in the People's Choice, so that was extraordinary. And then just 3 days ago, it won a Webby Award. And I have to tell you, I never knew about the Webbies. They are like the Oscars. This is the awards for, we're up against Nike and all sorts of organizations, huge, huge multi-billion dollar organizations. And our film won an award there at a Webby. So,
which is wonderful.
Okay, it's really made a difference. So I'm going to let you do your thing now.
Well, I will. I'll play the film now for you guys. I hope this plays well for you. I'm going to make double certain that it does, because I know that the issue with this, with sharing video through through a live broadcast, is the sound. So I'm going to hope that this works for you guys. If it doesn't, we're going to point you to where you can see this film after the event, because it's quite
luckily brilliant. Luckily, Dan, there's no narrative.
Yes, absolutely. So one of the things, just before we show this, one of the things that's key for you guys to understand, just to pop us back on screen before I play this, is that, and I want to reiterate this before you see it, we always try to talk about on this broadcast, what can you do in the very likely possibility that currently you aren't able to dip as deep into your pocket with the state of the world financially as well as everything else. What you can do is send this to people. Send this to your younger relatives who are just about to do their gap year, because they're the sort of people who will go on that voluntary working with lion cubs trip and be contributing to this. This is a piece of filmmaking genius, and rightly it won awards. Congratulations for that, Will. Let me just play the video and let it do the talking for us. And I hope that the sound works for you guys.
Born free, as free as the wind blows, as free as the grass grows, born free to follow your heart. Live free, and beauty surrounds you. The world still astounds you each time you look at a star. Stay free, where no walls divide you. You're free as a roaring tide, so there's no need to
So, you're going to have to talk for a little bit.
It is really hard to watch, and I must have seen that probably 40 times, 50 times. But, and I've watched the faces of people watching that, Dan, and they are they're sort of so filled with love for lions in the first half, the first three quarters of it, and the look of betrayal is exactly the right word. The look of betrayal in that last little section, as the animal trusting the person who raised him is then led onto the gun of the hunter by that very same person, is truly shocking. But the thing is, it's true. That's not made up. That's not fiction. That's actually what happens. And that's why we are so determined, with many other organizations and many individuals and the makers of Bloodlands and others, we're just determined that this kind of animal abuse, and it is animal abuse, there's nothing else to describe it as, must come to an end. It absolutely must come to an end.
And I mean, what an incredible piece of, what is that, two minutes long? What an incredibly powerful piece of filmmaking, but information sharing. Again, just to reiterate what I said beforehand, that's something to pass on to people. Share that far and wide. People will see that film, and I think part of the genius of it is that they'll right up until the very last few moments, they aren't understanding what message they're getting. By the time they get the message, it's too late. They can't unsee it, because there's a lot of apathy out there. There's a lot of cognitive dissonance and conscious detachment from these issues. You know, we see it all the time with various different animal issues. People would rather consciously distract themselves from it than face the reality. That film is a piece of genius that makes people face the reality. So thank you for making that. It's just, it breaks my heart every single time. And, you know, partly because it makes me think of King and the fact that, as you've, we've talked about it already tonight, you know, all of the, every single one of these animals has thoughts, feelings, a soul, and desires. You know, they have hopes and a will to live and a right to, and it's just being snatched away for the sake of all those things you just saw, making money all along the way at the expense of these incredible animals. So it's got to stop.
I think if you know, people watching this, they may, in a sense, I hope they never have a relationship with a lion or a tiger. But many of those of the people watching, you probably have a relationship with your dog or your cat, your companion animal. And I would defy anyone to say that that animal doesn't have a character and a soul, and to feel love and enjoy affection and to feel remorse, you know, maybe when they've done something wrong and been told off or whatever it happens to be. You know that that animal has feelings, and it's a two-way street. You benefit from the unconditional love that your companion animal offers you, and that animal also benefits from your love back and the fact that you look after your cat or whatever you happen to have. And so to try and dismiss wild animals as somehow being other than that, not having those same feelings, not being capable of having those same feelings, and therefore, going back to what we said before, to be able to treat wild animals as numbers and yet to care for your dog as an individual is intellectually corrupt.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And clearly, I mean, you've touched upon a really crucial point earlier on when you talked about the orthodontist who killed Cecil and the fact that he said if he knew that it had a name, he wouldn't have done so. Education is key. And Born Free are brilliant at that. And Rebecca has asked a question, which I put up on screen, relating to that film, because I think quite rightly she's asking, can that not be shown in schools, made part of the curriculum? Wouldn't it be wonderful if people were seeing that kind of thing in their formative years and developing that compassion, that empathy that's crucial to this cause, this endeavor?
Rebecca's question is great, and actually it opens a much wider discussion about school and what we should be teaching our children. And of course, the things that they are taught and the fantastic work that teachers do across the sort of the areas of study that we are familiar with, you know, English and maths and reading and history and geography and all those kind of things, and art are all, and music are absolutely vital. But I think that we still don't really understand that school is also there to prepare people for living and understanding our relationship with other people, creating a sense of community, a sense of understanding, giving us the life skills so that we can look after ourselves a bit. We don't have to, we don't fall apart when something goes wrong. We have no idea how to do it. How do you run a household budget? How do you run a bank account? How do you do all those things that actually are part of the functioning human being? How can you be emotionally mature, emotionally intelligent? How can you understand other people and understand why difference is not necessarily a bad thing? Difference is actually what makes it life so interesting, is that we are all different and we think, but also to have those common values. And right now, I think perhaps more than it's been for as long as I can remember, we have to think about our relationship with the natural world, because we are taking the planet, the human species is taking the planet to the brink of a cliff. If we continue to fly as much, drive as much, pollute as much, consume as much, fill the seas with plastic as much, abuse nature and forests and water resources the way that we have been doing, we're on a really short run to self-extinction. I mean, and the human race will disappear. But maybe that will be a good thing for various other forms of life on Earth. But I kind of don't want it to be like that. I want us to be true stewards of the natural world, to look after and nourish and nurture and cherish the natural world. And I don't think we can do that if we continue with our headlong rush about ourselves. It's so all about us all the time. And I think it starts in school, but it also needs to be recognized by our elected representatives, by our business leaders, by our teachers, by our religious communities, by our non-religious communities. It has to be embedded in everyone. And it seems extraordinary to me that we invest literally tens of billions of pounds a year in, for example, defense. And then we invest more than that in the education of our kids, quite rightly, and in our amazing National Health Service that has done the most outstanding job keeping us as safe as they possibly can under not safe circumstances. And we invest almost nothing in the planet. I will tell you that we all talk about climate change a lot, Dan. Obviously, we talk about climate change as being the thing that will ultimately destroy much of life on Earth or amend much of life on Earth. And we will probably find billions of people suffering, and maybe there are some winners as well. In terms of the investment that we as a species are making in trying to both understand and reverse climate change, in other words, studying climate change, we invest $10 per person per year. That's how much we put into investing in our future and how we will resolve climate change. And it seems to me absolutely crazy that we don't have the environment and the protection and care of our planet as an equal partner with education, with defense, with security, with the great organs of state. Why is it that our environment and caring for the planet, on which we all rely, is such a low priority when it comes to the way that we divvy up the cake?
Well, for you guys watching this, if you weren't sure why I love Will and the Born Free Foundation as much as I do before, I dare say you are now. Will, I mean, seriously, that's just everything you say. I agree wholeheartedly with it. Resonates deeply, and it's actually to an extent reassuring just to hear a human being articulate those sentiments. And as well as you do, you know, it's and I know for the folks watching, it's, and there are a lot of them, by the way, watching and commenting away, it's that kind of leadership that makes us think so highly of you and the Born Free Foundation. So thank you again. I mean, it's just unbelievable stuff that you're doing and talking about and guiding us towards that kind of a future. I could talk to you about lions forever, but I know that Born Free doesn't just do lions, deal with lion issues, and I'd love to talk about some of the other stuff you do. And I know you've got interests in various places around the world with some critically endangered animals, but one that I think far fewer people know about that you're heavily involved in is primates. And in the United States, you have a sanctuary, don't you? A rescue center.
You know, we do. And primates, for some reason, you know, we do talk about elephants a lot, and we do talk about tigers and lions and all sorts of species. But for some reason, primates, I think people do talk about primates when it comes to things like palm oil and orangutans. But otherwise, the plight of primates, great apes and not great apes, is often a bit invisible. And this is more of a captivity issue for us in some respects in the US, where we have Born Free USA. We have the biggest primate rescue center in the United States. We have nearly 500 rescued primates that have come from labs. They've been confiscated by the authorities from roadside zoos. They've come from private individuals who, it's really possible in America, and it is actually possible in the UK, but much more prevalent in the States, to keep a primate as almost a surrogate human being, as a little child. And people only kind of wise up to how incredibly stupid that is and incredibly dangerous it is when the primate shreds their couch or shreds their dog or shreds their friend or shreds their And then they go, oh, what have I done? And then, of course, what do they do? Because where can they offload this primate? So, you know, we have an amazing facility on nearly 200 acres down in Texas. We have nearly, as I say, 500 animals there. We have the amazing Dr. Liz Tyson, who is just, she is one of my absolute heroes. She is smart and intelligent and is super educated and can turn her hand to anything and is running that facility down there beautifully. And with her team of nine others looking after all those animals 24/7, they're actually in lockdown on site right now and have been for weeks. That's one that I take my hat off to. I really do.
And what, again, it's indicative of not just the incredible work that you do, but the breadth of the work that you do. I mean, just rattle off a few other examples. I know you have a number of different species you deal with around the world. Give people a sense of what else you guys deal with.
Well, we work hard for tigers in central India. We have a landscape level project. That means it's very extensive. It looks at a very, very large area of land connecting different tiger reserves. Tiger reserves are something that have been actually established by the Indian government. And what we do is we work with local non-government organizations in the space between the reserves so that it becomes one connected landscape. And we've seen a growth in tiger numbers in the Satpuda area over the last few years, which is really great news. We work on elephants. You'll not be surprised. I've been working on wildlife trade and ivory trade for a very long time, since 1989, at the big convention, this treaty called CITES, the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species. And people are quite critical of that convention, and we haven't got time to go into it now, but what I would say is, thank God that it exists, because if it didn't exist, it would be a complete free-for-all against wildlife, and there would be no checks and balances. And the fact that Born Free, as a member of the Species Survival Network, which we helped co-found in 1994, has been the precautionary voice within the CITES circle, saying, trying to raise issues, trying to say no, trying to say don't do this if you cannot demonstrate that it actually is not going to be negatively impactful on the animals, is if we weren't there and if it didn't exist, we would be in an awful lot worse state. And it's not perfect by any means. It needs reform, just like so many things do. But do not throw CITES away, because you will ultimately regret it. And the great news about elephants, Dan, is that, was it 3 or 4 days ago, the appeal that was lodged in the UK by the ivory dealers, those who were dealing in antique ivory and did not want to be restrained by the new government legislation, which virtually bans all commercial trade in ivory, that appeal was lost. And so as it stands, the government's measures, which came in recently, are in force. And this will demonstrate, I think, to the world that the UK wants no part of the ivory trade. And it's in sympathy with and in support of the great majority of African countries and Asian countries who want nothing to do with the ivory trade either. But there are some very loud voices out there that are in support of ivory trade, and they're only a handful, but they are very loud, and they tend to drown out the rest of us. Well, the UK has now stood up to be counted, and we should be thankful for that.
Right on. And something else we should be thankful for is, you've just alluded to the fact, you know, the ivory battle you've been fighting since 1989. This is indicative of how deeply involved in these issues you are. And as I said at the very beginning, it's a lifelong commitment from you and from the Born Free Foundation. And I remember we stood outside Parliament and spoke about this when they started to debate this very subject. Mm-hmm. And that was about 5 years ago.
You can't do this if you're in for the short haul. You can only do this if you're in for the long haul, and if you're prepared to be knocked down, and then you get up and you go back stronger and you think about it and you come back in a slightly different way. I mean, we've been supporting the conservation of the Ethiopian wolf. Who knew there was a wolf in Africa? Who knew? There is only one wolf species in the entire of Africa, and it's only found in Ethiopia. It's only found above 10,000 feet or 3,000 meters above sea level. And there are none in captivity. There's a stuffed one at the Natural History Museum. That's as close as you're going to get. They only live in that part of the Afro-Alpine environment of Ethiopia, and there are about 500 left. And when the rabies epidemic sweeps through, the number can fall by 25%. But we've been supporting that now for 20 years. We are the longest running supporter of the Ethiopian Wolf Conservation Program, which was run in conjunction with Oxford University and with the Ethiopian Wildlife Conservation Authority, that's the government.
Right.
Just like our relationship with the Kenya Wildlife Service in Kenya goes back to the founding days of the Kenya Wildlife Service in 1989. You know, you have to be there and you have to be in for the long haul.
Well, you talk about the long haul, and it's kind of, it gives me a really rather nice segue into something that I know you want to talk about, and I do too. So Angela and Martin are doing a bit of a long haul. What, can you explain a little bit about what Angela and Martin are doing and who they are?
Oh my goodness, these are two wonderful people. Angela Humphrey and Martin, her husband, are, and Martin is 90 and a half, and Angela is 89 and a half. So between them, they're 180 years old. He had open heart surgery recently. And I think to some degree inspired by the extraordinary Sir Colonel Tom Moore and his unbelievable efforts on behalf of the National Health Service, they have said, we are going to walk 3 kilometers a day for 2 months to raise funds to help Born Free tackle the wildlife markets that are, I think, now universally decided the source of where the coronavirus came from, a pandemic. And 70% of the pandemics that we have suffered over the last 20 years have all come from wildlife and wildlife, abused wildlife. So it's SARS and it's MERS and it's Ebola and it's coronavirus. And so, I mean, there's their fundraising page. We'd love it if people could offer some support. I'm going to do my 3 kilometer walk tomorrow in solidarity with Angela and Martin, because that's just extraordinary. And Ricky Gervais, who is a friend of animals all around the world and actually a friend, a personal friend of Angela and Martin, and also a supporter of Born Free, he has been saying, come on, everybody, let's get behind this. And There he is. Social distancing is the length of Angela's arm and her walking stick.
So again, a beautiful example of what people can do. So I'm going to also follow their lead and Will's and do several kilometers and try and raise some funds to contribute to Angela and Martin's unbelievable effort. So
that would
please
be
do check them out. And get involved.
They're on my Twitter. You've done it. You're so ahead of me. If you want to see a bit more, they are the pinned tweet. Ricky's little message, which is fabulous, is on my pinned tweet on my Twitter feed, which is at Will Travers. I think it's also on my Instagram feed, etc. And of course, you can go to the Born Free website, the Born Free Twitter feed, the Born Free Facebook, the Born Free Instagram. It's all there.
There you go. Exactly. That's exactly what we wanted to just cover with you guys, is that you can see exactly what Ricky had to say about this on Will's Twitter feed. You can see it at the bottom of the screen right there. It's at Will Travers. You can't get it wrong. Please get involved.
Yeah, no, get involved. And the other thing, talking about getting involved, Dan, is that I should have mentioned that our education team have been putting together some absolutely outstanding educational resources.
Amazing.
For people at home.
Are they on your website?
Yeah, teachers, yes, but also just for families and stuff that people can do, kids can do. It's fun, it's educational, it's got a wildlife and environment twist. So do check that out. We also have, I haven't mentioned really, but we should mention all our animal adoptions. We've got a new animal adoption that's out now, which is our rhino adoption. If you go to the Born Free website, you can find the adoptions. You can find the Learn at Home stuff. That's what we're calling it, Learn at Home. Look, there's my dear mum looking suitably cross, and quite rightly, about trophy hunting. I don't know, but you know, there's times to look cross, and
absolutely, absolutely.
With a whole lot of supporters, and thank you to them.
Absolutely, as always. Now, I just want to take a little detour. Just for a moment, and then I'm going to come right back to you, Will, and something you've actually just touched upon yourself. On Monday at 7 p.m., I will be talking to the wonderful Hollywood actor Shannon Elizabeth and Simon Borchert, who together run the Shannon Elizabeth Foundation. Now, you'll know Shannon Elizabeth from Hollywood films such as the American Pie franchise and Love Actually. But she is an absolutely staunch animal advocate and has committed her life to it. She now lives in South Africa, has created the Shannon Elizabeth Foundation, which does incredible work. And by the way, Will, just chatting with Simon recently, he asked me to pass on his very best regards. I know that you guys were due to meet and the lockdown prevented you from doing so.
Yeah, but I know his dad very well. I mean, that's a terrific team, a terrific outfit. And if we all do something, mm-hmm. no matter what that is, if all you can do is to take your window box and make sure that there's some pollinator-friendly flowers in there, if that's what you can do, then do it. Absolutely. And you can do anything from there on. Just it's what I always find frustrating is people go, I can't do anything. Right. There is actually always the food you choose, the window box you plant, the car journey that you didn't take because you decided to walk the half a mile to the store rather than to drive to the store. These are all cumulative actions that we can take, and we together can make a better world.
Again, just beautifully put. Thank you, Will. On Monday, I'm going to surprise you in terms of who I'm speaking to on Thursday, but I thought what would be rather lovely, Will, would be if you could just skip forward to next Saturday and tell everyone who I'll be introducing them to then.
Oh, no, wait. God, honestly, you lead me up the garden path and leave me standing by the gate. My mum is going to be on your show next Saturday at the same time as I was on today, and she is really looking forward to it. She's just loves a conversation, and I think that's what's so refreshing about this, Dan, is that and the viewers and listeners may not realize this, but we did not prep for this. My office sent about three things through to you that you could stick up on the screen just to illustrate things. But we spoke for what, 5 minutes before we went on air?
Yeah.
And decided that it was the free form of this show that would allow us to go in any direction we wanted to. And that's why it's exciting, why I get excited about these things, because it's not formulaic. We're literally picking up and sparking off stuff that we care about.
Absolutely. And it again underlines, and I'm going to get gushy, I know you don't appreciate it, but it underlines exactly why, I have so much love, respect and time for the Born Free Foundation and for you, your mum and the whole team, because you exemplify everything, as far as I'm concerned, that's good in the world and that we should all be working towards. And that future, you know, you give me hope for that future. I believe that we can do it. And when you inspire people as you do to get together, take action, and change things, I believe wholeheartedly we can do it. So, Will, thank you, my friend. It's always such a pleasure.
The honor has been mine. I've thoroughly enjoyed every minute. And if this chat for the last hour or so has inspired one person to just adjust their life course, their path a little bit, or has caused them to think that they don't need that yet another piece of plastic from the Far East, and they don't need to do this, but they could divert their attention in a more positive way, or they could show their child our Learn at Home materials, or whatever it is, that has been completely worth it.
Always beautifully put, and that was no exception. Guys, thank you so much for tuning in.
Thank you, everybody.
It's been such a pleasure. It's been so, again, thank you for being so interactive and engaged. but the fact that you've been so means that it's much more difficult for me to keep up with all of your comments and questions. So I apologize if I've missed any. I've missed most of them, but it's really wonderful of you guys to be so engaged. And Will, once again, thank you personally and also to Born Free and the entire team there for everything you do.
Dan, I've been looking at all those names coming up and some I recognize. And all I will say to everyone who either knows us or doesn't know us, you are welcome to be members of the Born Free family.
Well, we'll all take that opportunity. Absolutely.
Thanks, Dan.
Thank you, Will. We'll continue speaking right now. But guys, thank you so much. Spread the love. Stay safe. And we'll see you on Monday at 7 p.m. Night night.
Good night.